deciding which part of my research I would have shared, even if all of them are in process and no one can be considered like finished, I set my proposal here in relation to the narrative of the dissonant heritage across cultures, stimulated by the call from Lexia 3940. And my proposal is very briefly to understand if and how the visage interplay with that issue. So the title of this presentation finally is like this, Facade and Faces in Transcultural and Dissonant Urban Facts. So first, we briefly, we are first treating separately the element of the title, the treat of lexema as the textual entity in volley terms, stitching together first theoretically a little bit and secondly by complementing with the case studies. Each case, it will be part of a specific cultural horizon, all of them distant from each other, but connected to some point as dissonant narrative and face representation, as we will see. Started with the dissonance, we stay a while in the sphere of the sound, its field of belonging, by introducing its counterpart, consonance. We mean an agreement, tacit or explicit, with the sound. In the case of consonance, we will have a favorable disposition and predisposition towards the sound of complacency, while in dissonance, the prefix D, which in this case implies deprivation, contributes to the noun assuming a negative value, thus indicating any approach that produces a disharmonious or discordant effect. According to Schomburg, one of its greater exponents, known as the dissonant composer, we quote, the expression consonance and dissonance, which signify antitheses, are false. It all simply depends on the growing ability of the analyzing ear to familiarize itself with the remote overtone, thereby expanding the conception of what is euphonious, suitable for art, so that it embraces the whole natural phenomenon. In other words, still remaining in sonance terms, the consonance has been like accepted, meanwhile the dissonance has been rejected through, until the moment in which the canon of belonging is rediscussed and the phonic system is of reference is re-elaborated in a sort of semiotic term. So from being considered as a kind of disruption, dissonance is slowly becoming a way of hearing, the modalizing perception. And this is how it has been introduced in heritage researches. So what we refer when we're speaking about dissonant narrative or fact or heritage and their synonyms, it can be possible to be the difficult one. In terms of Kizik, and we quote, it, the dissonance, is placed at the very center of understanding heritage as a space of negotiation, dissent and conflict, which needs to be acknowledged and mediated. Let's stay a moment longer to this point, because it's a little bit delicate, introducing another fundamental level that is the memory, and referring to the beautiful book from Patrizia Violi, 2014, The Trauma, the Space and the History. Because also the memory, and especially the memory of difficulties, aspects are related with this kind of negotiation. Memory is not in the media in which it is inscribed, and we are quoting, it is not deposited in the texts, but in the process of construction, interpretation, and translation of meaning that underlies them. We are referring here especially to a memory about difficult or dissonant facts, tangible or not, because from them it may emerge the trauma. In terms of violi, compared with the hub in individual or social memory. Actually, in this kind of constructive memory, and eventually so in trauma, the collective one, that she argued in her text, and quoting again, sites are not only places of memory in themselves, but they participate in the construction and reconstruction of the sense of the past. They systematize with the other text, they participate in the distributed nature of collective memory. In this passage, we are like attributing them a kind of entitarian status, assuming as a kind of personhood, attributing qualities to the substances and materials of the world, to the places. And quoting Fowler of 2004, he said, the substances with the generative qualities are not just circulated between human bodies, but can be circulated among the world at large and can be found contained in the bodies of buildings, objects, plants, and animals. And we are closing the quote. So what part of this world can we relate it to? In this presentation, we are referring to the urban context, the urban facts, the built heritage, and specifically we are entering in a part of them, which are the facade. But first, as you see the screen, it's necessary to clarify one more thing. We are not referring to the heritage of AHD paradigm, so authorized heritage discourse, but with the newest inclusive heritage discourse paradigm in force in the last years. And as we can see from the diagram, implies more inclusion, dynamism, dialogue, negotiation of dissonance and transversality. The facade, from limiting itself exclusively to its exterior character, is instead approached by the interface textual entity, that area of the threshold, the contact surface, the outermost part of that, due to its location, assumes the meaning of liminality. Tangible heritage assume a communal topographical role and is one of the fundamental textual elements to establish discursive continuity with the collectivities. So facade is, and we are quoting, the link between durable tangible heritage and the idea of continuity of people across generation. Facade roots brings back to the face, to the skin. A face approach, and we are quoting, as you see in the screen, from Levinas 2006, a contact with the skin, a face weighted down with the skin, and the skin is which, even in obscenity, the altered face breathes. So this face, this skin, are already absent from the self, fallen into the past with an unrecuperable lapse. The skin caresses is not the protection of an organism, simply the surface of an entity, but it is the divergence between the visible and invisible, the quasi-transparent, thinner than that which would still justify an expression of the invisible by the visible. This thinness is not an infinitesimal degree of quantity of thickness. So a connection with the facade from the face is evident, and the dialogic aspect of the facade should be emphasized. The facade is involved inside and outside. It fulfills the action of covering and receives the coverture. It is vulnerable to re-signification. It is the role of the architecture interspaced, the aftertaste of the events of histories, those familiar and those social. It's condensed and exalted. It is the face of the building somehow, whose otherness is reflected in the external gaze, that which requires a commitment, a committed emptiness linked in between a signifying nexus between two expressive surfaces. And still again quoting Levinas, who said, the for oneself of identity is now no longer for itself. The subject is for another. Its own being turns into for another. Its being dies away, turning into signification, closing the quote. So we need also mention the portrait very briefly as a kind of paradox between the mystery of elusivity and a revelation flashing. So quoting Jean-Louis Nancy, revelation flashing that can only be done, as it refers to portrait, it can only be done on condition that the structure of the subject is uncovered. Subjectivity, it's being under itself, it's being within itself, therefore outside, backwards or forwards, to produce subject, to drive it forward, to bring it out. This is the goal, the purpose of the portrait. So can be this following case studies considered as a part of this individual organization or institution that are consciously working with dissonance and using it in the context of political ideals such as reconciliation, peace building, human rights or inclusion mentioned before in IHD, and how language of art can contribute to the narration of the dissonance. Are the facade, the skin of the buildings, the faces of the urbanity? These are all questions I will not answer really today and maybe never, but just to enrich the conversation and the doubt to follow with them. So is it the portrait engaging the compromise of material and energy forces, referring to Fontenelle terms, in a kind of contact in an electromagnetic semiotic field? Let's see the three case studies very briefly. The first one is about the patrimonialization of an historical character through the homage of, to this, his faces in the design of contemporary architectural building. And quoting Levinas, the beings remain always assembled, present in a presence that is extended by memory and history to the totality determined like matter, a present without fissures or surprises from which becoming is expelled, a present large made up of representation due to memory and history, closing quote. William Barak, as we saw in the building, born in Australia in 1824 and died in 1903, was an artist representative of the traditional values of the Aboriginal Wurundjeri clan and an activist in their spiritual and material defense against colonial appropriation. The portrait of Barak, resulting from an optical play of panel whose shape uses full empty contrast, which reflects the blacks and white of the initial image to determine the result. And it is not visible from close up, but needs a distance and a view from somewhere in the city to be appreciated. It shows by breaking into an innovation in the gender of something that we can call urban portrait, the dialogical character of the facade, including the inhabitants in an action in the perspective of both synchronic aesthetic act and the diachronic historical moment. In this ITER, the architecture proposed a rereading of intangible heritage, but making it more material and visible, which questions and redimension issue of power and responsibility in a process that creates and recreates social relation about both past and present. So let's follow with the second case study. The patrimonialization of a subaltern zone in one of the most emblematic borders of the world, the one that divides the United States with Mexico, to a border art installation whose protagonist is the face of a large-scale child that many of you sure know, that takes hold of the great dividing wall. The first is a photograph, the second one is a lithography, and these border walls are special facades, showing their faces from both sides, absorbing what comes to them from the cities to which they politically belong, and insofar as they are geographical liminal, incorporating in themselves the geography and the epistemic load of the other sides. Otherness and similarities seem to blend into a double side facade, and yet their physical forcefulness underline their devices and insurmountable character. In history, there have been many walls of these types in different latitudes, some of which have been demolished and remain as visible heritage. We are referring to the dividing wall between these two parts, the US and Mexico. Still in process, these walls, its construction has been an economic, political, social project whose purpose would be to resolve illegal migratory transition, would be, it seems that the replacement of the physical wall still in construction, it will be a surveillance wall. This is the moment in which this is the contemplation of the changing to the surveillance wall, which would imply the disappearance of the physicality of a material construction in order to materialize the gaze of control. So this is an installation, and we are quoting a little bit from J.R., the artist, that called lithography Migrants Picnic Across the Border. Quoting him, he said, "We organize a gigantic picnic across the border with Mexico, connecting people in two countries for one shared meal." Kikito is the his family and is the person, the child. So Kikito and his family and hundreds of guests come from US and Mexico to share meal together. People gather around the eyes of the dreamer, eating the same food, sharing the same water, enjoying the same music. So he quoting other quote saying, "We forgot the wall for a minute." Closing the quote. So this race is an important point that we have no way of wrapping up now, which is that of forgetting and how, while memory can take of a catalytic and dialoguing function, oblivion can also take of an active position and turn out to be a sublimating or constructive narrative strategy, forgetting the wall for a while. Some question would be arise, how big and deep is the archival space for remember? Or other question would be, how is the space of oblivion constituted, and how does it function, and what is its purpose? What types of sign are constituted through this process, and what text or narratives are produced from this modalization of forgetting? And the third case study, a little more personal and close to an ethnographic experience, having a few years ago in Mexico, the patrimonialization of daily life and local knowledge through the interactive with its inhabitants and with the intervention of artistic mediator. So this project was from Secretary of Culture, and especially from the photographer called well-known Antonio Turok. In 2016, we were in Octun village in the Yucatan state, and the urban action initially it consisted of making contact with the local inhabitants, approaching their territorial and personal dynamics, exchanging life stories, shares, intergroup moments. Later on, we moved on the recording of the moment. An artistic documentary photography became a space, becoming a share and mutual constructive negotiation. The symbolic action of positioning oneself in the gaze of all the treating gave way to new tools of positioning, not so much individual, but cultural. Knowledge left aside and the languages almost abandoned the need, invigorating dynamics. That's why we speak about the patrimonialization of daily life. To rediscover the strength to move forward. Suddenly the story already written, though sedimented in the retrospective portion of being, are let go either by context or necessity, the language of art with its capacity to respect the steps by skipping them can offer alternative and complementary models to the dissonance of and in the heritage. And let's almost finish. Synthetically, we saw the creative and formative in Hecchian terms, nature of memory, an heuristic process that requires personal contribution and the continuous revision and interaction in order to become collective. We have seen possibility to reestablish or disaggregate dissonance and how collective action can, the action can participate to build this kind of memory in respect to the tangible heritage reformulation of urban facts. We have also seen the role of the walls in there, and we are quoting our colleague Simona Stano in her beautiful text, Rewriting and Regeneration, in a beautiful big text co-created by other colleagues, Cristina Voto. So he speaks about tactic use, quoting, the tactics pretend to break out with gray silence on the walls and to restore the visibility that is being taken away from them. And in the specificity, in the closing the quote, in the facade of the wall. We have seen the strong connection between space and facade in a kind of comparison where we could say that part of what is being studied of the face, its narrative character that makes in it an argument of constant writing and personalizing reading could be contemplated in the study of the facade through the study of personhood. We have imagined that this type of representation emblem that cross culture and time could be called maybe urban portraits. The study of urban facts as place of co-constructed collective memory, and specifically the approach to the facade as contemporary reality that shaped the history ascribed to them, and allow us to participate in it by providing content through their epidermical densities. It leads us to a reflection of the face too. So the face is a semiotic mechanism to confront and perhaps move away from the most terrible version of the human being, a figurative semiosphere of accumulating, reworking and maybe overcoming individual and collective trauma, a valued heritage to glimpse and find the most poetic version of the inhabited territory. Yes, I would like to finish with a small homage to this beautiful work chosen by Professor Massimo Leone, an homage to Hak Xian, the author of this beautiful work, showing part of his process. So as you see, there is the final step and the process that is remembering us, is explaining the process of porcelain and remembering the underskin of this of these words and maybe of the facades and of the face. Thank you very much for your attention.